the runaway success of the podcast Serial has reignited interest in the true crime genre, a deep journalistic dive into an actual criminal case. But the Netflix series Making a Murderer has critics asking if the need to tell a good story is coming at the expense of the facts. Making a Murderer presents the strange case of Stephen Avery, who spent 18 years in prison for a rape he didn't commit. After his release, he sued officials in Manitowoc County, Wisconsin.
We're seeking compensation for the loss of his freedom and punitive damages for the reckless or indifferent behavior of the defendant.
But in the middle of Avery's civil suit, he was charged and ultimately convicted for the murder of Teresa Halbeck, a 25-year-old woman who had come to Avery's salvage yard to photograph a car.
We, the jury, find the defendant, Stephen A. Avery, guilty of first-degree intentional homicide.
But the filmmakers behind Making a Murderer raise considerable doubts about Avery's conviction, including questionable evidence.
We found a key.
That key was scrubbed and his DNA was placed on it.
This is really strange.
What's going on here?
The film suggests investigators, some who worked on Avery's botched rape conviction, were out to get him. It's all created quite a stir.
Making a Murderer has reignited interest in a crime that vanished from the public spotlight.
And it's sparking a nationwide debate now about the criminal justice system.
It's even launched petitions for a presidential pardon. But the prosecutor in Avery's murder case says filmmakers cherry-picked the evidence.
This wasn't a documentary at all. This was a defense piece. It was generated by and for Stephen Avery by his defense team.
The filmmakers, Laura Riccardi and Moira Demos, maintain that fairness was fundamental to the series.
Our question going in was never about guilt or innocence or about trying to solve this crime. It was really an exploration into the system.
Okay, but isn't guilt or innocence ultimately the point? Yeah, that's a lot of hogwash. And can we just say, this is a television show. This is an entertainment program. It's not a documentary. That's what it is. I know they use some journalistic skills and a little like Serial. Serial was also an entertainment program, and Sarah Koenig herself has said that. She says, you know, there's this uncomfortable, is it okay to be entertained by somebody's miserable life story? And, you know, you got to come down on the side of yes if that's what you're doing.
Well, you know, I'm uncomfortable in talking about Making of a Murderer because I haven't seen it. But I was a serial junkie last year.
Yeah.
And what I would say about Serial that, from my understanding, is not the case with this Netflix documentary, is that Sarah Koenig agonized over the case. And she'd go back and forth.
Sure.
Is this guy guilty? Is he not guilty? And I think that ultimately all journalists can really do is show where a trial may have gone wrong. Maybe somebody received an unfair trial. You can't necessarily go back and prove guilt or innocence. I mean, that's more in the realm of fiction than journalism. You know, Harvey Silverglate likes to use a phrase, framing the guilty.
Mm-hmm.
And this is often what happens.
Yeah.
Because the police don't necessarily trust their own evidence, so they do everything they possibly can to make a case against somebody who they firmly believe to be guilty.
And probably is.
Probably is, but every so often the person isn't guilty.
Right.
Well, I can jump in because I didn't listen to Serial, and nor did I do I intend to watch Making of a Murderer, both because I don't like that kind of ongoing true crime-ish, could be in real story stuff. However, what I have learned from people who were avid listeners and watchers is that Serial came across to many people, to your points, that the producer was really involved in the individual story of this guy. For people who are watching Making of a Murderer, they're coming away with, hey, this system, we got to look at this system. This Stephen Avery case may be the focal point, but to a person who is really involved that I've talked to, they've come away with questions about, we cannot accept wholesale that the justice system operates as they say it does, that we need to question that. And maybe this guy is or is not innocent, but more that's brought to the point is that there's a lot of holes in the way the process works.
It's fascinating you say that because I've just started to watch this in part
one.
Because we were doing this show today. So I've read a ton about it. The Catherine Schultz take on this in The New Yorker, which I thought was a great piece for the most part, raised the opposite point from the friend of yours who's been watching it. She had a complaint, say, friends. Mm. She said, this is too much about the one story and not enough about a system that needs changing. Some of the stuff they left out strikes me, having just begun to watch it, as really important. Stephen Avery called this woman
Left out by the filmmakers, you mean, yeah.
Left out by the filmmakers. He called her three times on the day she was murdered. That doesn't get a mention. He had been previously accused of rape. Yeah. That doesn't get a mention. His sweat was found on her car. That doesn't get a mention. It's sort of basic rhetoric that, you know, if you want to make your case, that's fine. Make your case. Include all the counter arguments and then explain why they are not problematic. And they didn't do that, and as a result, I think that the text loses credibility.
Do these filmmakers claim to be journalists?
Yeah, they say it's a documentary. They're calling it a documentary.
But not a docudrama.
Not all documentaries are journalistic.
No, I know. They're calling it a documentary.
Well, they're not.
Yeah, okay? That's what I said.
And we talked about this a while back with that hideous CNN documentary about that case Harvard Law School, where they say right in their own writings, you know, we have our minds made up about this. I don't want to use the word lie. That's such a rude word. So let's stipulate that. Police and prosecutors, unfortunately, too often, become so convinced of an end result that they don't worry about truth and facts and fairness on the way to achieving that result, as Dan mentioned. Well, you know what? Journalists do that too sometimes, and so do these pseudo-alleged journalists. And I think we're looking at a case right now of that kind of thing. You cannot ignore relevant evidence. Well, that just didn't make the cut. No, there goes your credibility down the toilet.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I mean, to that point, I do think that it's perfectly fair for a documentary maker to go into a story like this with the idea of testing a hypothesis. And the hypothesis is this guy got an unfair trial and he might even be innocent. But then once you define the hypothesis that you're going to test, you have to go where the facts lead you.
Right.
And if you come across an uh-oh moment, well, maybe you don't have a film, or maybe you have a very different kind of film from what you had originally intended.
And if you leave something out that is going to make people after the fact say, I can't believe they didn't include A and B and C and D, then you're making a mistake. Sorry, Kelly.
I just want to add that 60 Minutes for a while did a number of reports. They weren't called documentaries, but they're regular reports, in which they went to, got a guy who's been saying the whole time, I'm innocent, and they went back and pulled up every single fact and put it together, and several of those people were let go because they were able to prove in their story these things were not considered. If it wasn't as carefully done as that, there you go.
And to go back to Serial, I'm sure that Sarah Koenig did not want to end the first season of Serial saying, I don't know whether this guy did it or not,
but
she was honest enough to do that.
And the scary part is so many people believe crap like this is the real deal.
Well, that's true, too. Yeah.